They were the center of the Poi community for more than a decade, and as of last year, they've decided to call it quits. I'm talking, of course, about Home of Poi, the global seller of fire props and all things Poi. They used to be huge, so how exactly did we get here? Drex here from Drex Factor Poi, sharing with you the love of Poi spinning and flow arts, and today we're going to talk about a chapter of Poi history that is now closing. What happened to Home of Poi? Before we dive in, I just want to give a quick shout out to the friends of the channel. Big thanks to Dark Monk, Flow DNA, Flow Fests, Flow Toys, Juggling Calling, Pyroterra Light Toys, Spinballs, and Ultrapoi for helping to make the videos on this channel possible. You can learn more about all these amazing companies and the work that they're doing to support flow artists like yourself by checking out the links that I've got down in the description of this video. And a special thanks to the first non-business friend of the channel, Johnny Howard. Thanks so much for your support, Johnny. So I'll say from the drop that I've never spoken to or messaged the staff at Home of Poi directly. What I'm going to share here isn't insider information or personal stories of the company's demise. And that's because I wasn't actually surprised when they announced that they were closing down. If you've been watching the flow arts industry through the 2010s, then the question wasn't if they'd shut down, but when. What I'm going to do today is guide you through the same tea leaves that I've been reading now for the past decade to show how we got here and how the warning signs were out there for anyone to see. So let's start with context. When I first entered the fire spinning world in 2007, Home of Poi was at the height of their influence. Not only were they the most trusted name for purchasing all Poi-related products, but that influence also extended to other fire props like staffs and even hoops. Their website was basically a showcase of what props were making an impact in the fire spinning world, to say nothing of what possibilities there were for mixing and matching various different parts to create new ones. If I could list out the key advantages Home of Poi had at the time, they'd basically break down as such. Number one, they were essentially the only source, or at least the only name brand source, for many fire props and parts for manufacturing fire props. I think they realized that a huge part of the appeal for fire spinning at that time was its underground DIY ethos. The people that spun fire not only enjoyed thinking about what props they could come up with, but also tremendously enjoyed the process of physically making them. I remember this period, and every trip to the hardware store felt like the beginning of a fantasy novel quest. Thus, selling both complete sets of props as well as the parts to make them was a really smart move. Beyond being a source for both people that wanted to make props as well as just buying them, selling parts also means you pay nearly no labor costs. It was an easy way to sell the same stuff and make more profit off of it. Number two, at the time, they were the only source for decent quality LED props. Believe it or not, it's an order of magnitude harder putting together LED props with off-the-shelf components than it is fire props. Aside from the Kevlar, literally all the parts I needed to make sets of fire poi could be found at my favorite hardware store when I started spinning in Boulder, Colorado. But LED props? Now you gotta worry about batteries, wiring, programming, to say nothing of how durable your work needs to be because props get dropped a lot. Number three, they could operate at scale. Because they had almost no competition, they could mass produce items that were better quality than many of the hacked versions people could produce in their garages with parts from the hardware store. I can remember when fire fans first started to take off, and the best DIY solution I saw for them here involved twisting up chicken wire to try and create small and maneuverable fans. The Home of Poi fans weren't perfect, but they looked far more polished and were far more durable. Home of Poi could make gambles on things like them, as well as the first generation of contact and non-stretchy sock poi. Few other players had the capital to be able to produce a product that was good enough and still affordable. Number four, they had a handle on viral marketing before the social media era. So if you've ordered from Home of Poi, you know that big stack of cards they send you that includes an affiliate code made up just for you. But why did they do this? Fire spinning and flow arts had and continue to have a big marketing problem. Not only are there relatively few practitioners, but the most common way to see them is to go to a special event. But let's say that you do happen to be that one person in your community that spins a prop, much less spins fire, and as people come up to you after, they're super keen to find out what equipment you're using. Why? Here's the website to go to, and wouldn't you know it, I can get you a discount there. It turned every customer into a potential source of marketing, and it made you feel special if you were one of them. It created an incentive to get other people on board, and that was good not just for you, but also for Home of Poi itself. Number 5, they made smart investments in community. First, they hosted tutorials on their site. The biggest obstacle to the adoption of any prop is the learning curve to pick it up and become proficient at it. Offering tutorials not only gives people ideas for what they can learn next, it also means that even if they don't live nearby anybody who knows how to spin, they can still get involved and, more importantly, become a customer. Second, they hosted community forums where people could exchange ideas and build points of contact from hundreds of miles away. This became an incubator for the emerging tech poi movement, as well as a way for people to still feel a sense of community, even if they were geographically isolated. And it should be said, consulting tutorials and engaging with the forums also meant that people were more likely to spend more time on the website, and thus, a result in more sales. Third, they found ways both to promote the art as well as make people feel seen by putting together yearly compilations of the best videos submitted by customers. Having a DVD for people to buy and show their friends that they'd made it also gave the company another product to sell with minimal investment. It really seemed like Home of Poi was positioned to rule the flow arts market coming into the 2010s. So how did it all go wrong? Number one, the biggest mistake the company ever made was not opening up a US-based manufacturing or distribution hub. It wasn't hard to deduce that the biggest source of their orders for most of the last decade of their operation came from the United States, a country that it typically took them 2 weeks to ship to. Once you realize the majority of your sales are coming from just one country, it's either you work to reduce delivery times to it, or you wait for competitors to emerge that will beat you to it. It took a while, but for the past 8 years, there has been both a US-based or European-based company offering a comparable product to everything in the Home of Poi store, and delivery times are half of what they would be shipping from New Zealand. Number two, they got complacent on their products. Those of us that remember their LED props also remember how janky they were. At one point, I had a process for adding tin foil to the switches in their LED poi heads to try and make them work again once they'd broken down from use. As flow and fire arts grew to bigger and bigger audiences, they also grew to include people that didn't want to make a project out of building their own props. They wanted something that was ready to go and, above all, polished and a professional product. When your products are made in the knowledge that they might have to be assembled by inexperienced hands, it restricts the options you have for refinement. Other companies specialized in products that individually were a vast improvement over what Home of Poi offered, and in many cases, Home of Poi just didn't bother updating their own offerings. They stocked and resold those new products, hoping to become a marketplace. Which leads us to number three. Everything they did, somebody else wound up doing it better. Do tutorials? YouTube became a better host. You could make higher quality videos and connect directly with your audience, to say nothing of how much easier it was to discover new content on the platform as opposed to digging through pages of search results. The forums? That was an easy feature to copy. Whether it was Sphericulism or the Tech Poi group on Tribe, there were competitors eating away at this function right from the beginning. But they frequently shared an audience with Home of Poi rather than completely supplanting it. So what was the straw that broke the camel's back here? Why, it was the same thing that killed Tribe when Facebook relaunched groups in 2010. See, people were already on Facebook, and the groups function not only gave them the capacity to have the same kinds of conversations that we're used to having on other platforms, but the interface was way sleeker. Posts would include previews of videos or sites that they were linking to, and every response to a post would come with a notification. It was a super addictive form of interaction, and overnight, it ate up the audiences for most traditional forum systems on the internet. And their attempts at becoming a marketplace? Two words, Amazon and Etsy. The compilation videos? Again, when YouTube is a thing, people can just go there to promote themselves rather than trying to get a spot on your DVD. Number four, the focus of the community switched in that decade. Rather than having an international community focused on online interactions with infrequent gatherings, the focus of the Flow community in the 2010s switched over to in-person fire and flow events, especially in the United States. Not only were these places where people could connect with other like-minded artists, they were also places where attendees could try out props in their own hands and talk face-to-face with the owners of these companies, building trust and rapport. Home of Poi never sent representatives to these events, so those relationships wound up being cultivated with other vendors who were much closer. Number five, their marketing approach was a dud in the social media era. Remember those cards with affiliate codes that they gave to literally everyone that ordered from them? Well, it feels cool and exclusive when you're the only one, or maybe one of a handful of people in your area that have them. But in a Facebook group where literally everyone has them and is trying to talk somebody into using their code, Not only do they become completely useless, they also become a nuisance. All of a sudden, a marketing tactic that looked brilliant when online communication was still comparatively limited became hopelessly outdated and even a little bit cringy on a platform like Facebook. To say nothing of the switch to influencer-based marketing. For a brief time, Home of Poi did try to convince some big names in the flow world to create new tutorials for them, or give their affiliate codes a bigger push through their platforms. But neither wound up really generating a lot of traffic. The new tutorials didn't generate much traffic, and many influencers lost interest once options in their home country appeared, or they discovered that the company was starting to have problems with customer service. Bookmark that. We'll talk about that a little bit more in a moment. Of course, knowing what we do now, if Home of Poi had invested heavily in creating its own content or in distribution hubs in key markets, they potentially could have stayed in the game. But what really doomed them was losing the goodwill of both their suppliers and their customers. Which leads me to my last point. Number 6, their brand took hits that it never recovered from. Even as they were trying to build a marketplace out of products created by their competitors, the relationships there were, shall we say, more than a little tense. The terms of this relationship always tilted heavily in Home of Poi's favor, and I've heard now from a few people that offered products through them that the relationship they cultivated with their suppliers were frequently kind of tense or even outright antagonistic. Which makes sense if you think that you're the biggest name in town and these upstarts are respecting neither your business nor the power of your brand. But once these upstart brands start to take off, it becomes a different story. Now you need those relationships to improve the visibility of your own storefront rather than the other way around. And of course, the real elephant in the room. The quality of their service declined over their final years of operation. Go to their Facebook page and you'll see many complaints from people not only upset about the quality of the props that they received from Home of Poi, but unable to get a hold of anybody at the company to address their concerns. Building a brand isn't that difficult. You create an idea and a story that people latch onto and want to be a part of. But once the cracks start to show in the idea and people lose their trust in it, it's almost impossible to get that trust back. You have to do some major course correction. And of course, the final nail in the coffin landed with the COVID-19 pandemic, when it became impossible for them to update their inventory and the world shipping networks effectively ground to a halt. They might have kept trudging on for a little while afterwards, but after the decline they'd entered into, there was no escape. COVID just finished them off. It's sad to see a company that so many of us had a relationship with decline and come to such an end, but at the same time, I think there are important lessons to be learned here, especially for people who run businesses themselves. One of the biggest is that no matter how big or established, companies have to keep on innovating, or they'll slowly face extinction. What if Home of Poi had stayed on the bleeding edge of LED props? What if they'd been the first to get to Technora? Next, you can be the right company for a given period of time, but the wrong one when the unique social trends that led to that era are disrupted. Home of Poi's marketing tactics and manufacturing processes were unquestionably the perfect fit for the 2000s, but they were horribly out of touch when social media and fire festivals hit in the 2010s. And yes, for all of you out there who've managed to be successful in the 2010s, this is also a reminder that it's already time to start thinking about what will become the important trends in the coming decade if you want to stay relevant. And finally, people will forgive a lot, but they won't forgive being taken for granted. Regardless of how much your brand has been an institution before, if you take your customers for granted, they will leave you without a second thought. Seriously, don't squander goodwill if you've built it. So, those are my thoughts on why Home of Poi is closing down. I do have fond memories of their products long ago, but I'm also excited to see what new opportunities will take seed for other companies in the ashes of this one. Did you get anything out of this video? Please make sure to like, share, comment, and subscribe to help other people find it and to help my channel grow. I also just wanted to put out a huge thank you because this video would not be possible without the kind contributions of these wonderful folks right here. These are my Flow patrons on Patreon, and they, along with the wonderful people listed down in the description, make this video and all the videos on my channel possible. If you'd like to help me out in my mission to bring Poi spinning and flow arts to the wider world and help people learn to be creative with their brains and their bodies, you can do so by heading over to patreon.com/drexfactorpoi and signing up. You can get early access to all of my content, a say in what topics I tackle in the future, plus some great extras and behind the scenes content as well. So go check that out. Please and thank you. What did you think of my analysis? Were there things that I left out? Would you like to see me do this kind of analysis on other companies? Let me know down in the comments and feel free to share your own stories about Home of Poi. I will include a link to a playlist on other videos I've done about business and the flow arts down in the description, as well as up on screen if you're watching on YouTube. Make sure to get outside and flow today, and I'll see you with a new video on Wednesday. Peace.